My name is Amanda Grissom, and I have the pleasure of being the director for the show you're about to see, Pieces of Glass Fell. As you will note in your program, this is actually two one-act plays, Trifles and Woman's Honor, both written by early feminist author Susan Glassfell. I want to take this opportunity to invite you to step into that world. It is the world of 1916 and 1918, respectively, 100 years ago, when cell phones had not been invented yet. So I ask you please to now take yours out, either silence it or turn it off. I do ask that they not be put on vibrate. In a small space like this, even vibrate can be really distracting. There is also going to be a 10-minute intermission, and during that time, I invite you to step onto the lobby and enjoy some cookies and lemonade offered by Monmouth College's Crimson Mass Theater Interest Group and Alpha Psi Omega Theater Honor Society. Other than that, enjoy the shows, and thank you so much for coming.
This feels nice. Come up to the fire, ladies.
I'm not cold.
Well, before we move things about, Mr. Hell, you explain to Mr. Henderson just what you saw before you came here yesterday morning.
By the way, has anything been moved? Is everything just as you left it yesterday?
It's just about the same. When it dropped below zero last night, I thought I'd better send Frank out to make a fire for us. No use in getting pneumonia with a big case on. But I told them not to touch anything except the stove. And you know Frank.
Someone should have been left here yesterday.
Oh, yesterday when I had to send Frank out to Moore Center for that man who went crazy. I want you to know that I had my hands full yesterday. I knew you'd get back from Omaha by today. And as long as I went over everything here
well,
myself.
Well, Mr. Hale, just tell what happened when you got here yesterday morning.
Harry and I had started to town with a load of potatoes. As we came along the road from my place, I said to Harry, I'm going to see if I can't get John Wright to go in with me on a party telephone. I'd talked to Wright about the idea once before, but he put me off, saying folks talk too much anyway, and all he asked was peace and quiet. I guess you know about how much he talked himself. But I thought if I went to his house and talked about before his wife, though I said to Harry I didn't know what his wife wanted to make much difference to John.
I think I'd like to talk about that later, Mr. Hale. I would like to talk about that, but tell now just what happened when you got to that house.
I didn't hear or see anything. I knocked, and still it was all quiet inside. I knew they had to be up. It was past 8 o'clock. So I knocked again, and I thought I heard somebody say, come in. I wasn't sure. I'm not sure yet, but I opened the door, this door, and there, in that rocker, sent Mrs. Wright.
And what was she doing?
She was rocking back and forth. She had her apron in her hands and was kind of tweaking at it.
And how did she look?
Well, she looked queer.
How do you mean queer?
Well, as if she didn't know what she was going to do next and kind of done up.
And how did she seem to feel about your coming?
I don't think she minded, one way or other. She didn't seem to pay much attention. I said, "How do, Mrs. Wright? It's cold out, ain't it?" And she said, "Is it?" And just went on, pleating up her apron. Well, that surprised me. She didn't ask me to come to the stove or to sit down, but just sat there, not even looking at me. I said I came to see John, and then she laughed. I guess you would call it a laugh. I thought of Harry and the team outside, so I said a little sharp, "Can't I see John?" "No," said she, kind of dull-like. "Why, ain't he home?" says I. "Yes, he's home." "Then why can't I see him?" I asked her out of patience. "'Cause he's dead," said she. "Dead," says I. She just nodded her head, not getting a bit excited. "Why, where is he?" says I, not knowing what else to say. That, she pointed, like that. I started for the stairs with the intention of going up there. I got from there to here. When I asked her, "Why, what did he die of?" "He died of a rope around his neck." Well, I went outside and got Harry. I thought I might need help. We went upstairs, and there he was lying there.
I think I'd like to have you go into that later, Mr. Hale. When we're upstairs, where you can point it all out. Just go on now with the rest of the story.
Well, my first thought was to get that rope off from around his neck. It looked... But Harry went up to him and said, "No, he's dead all right, and we better not touch anything." We went back downstairs. She was still sitting in that same way. "Has anybody been notified?" I asked. "No," said she. "Who did this, Mrs. Wright?" said Harry. He said it business-like, and she stopped pleating up her apron. "I don't know," said she. "You don't know?" said Harry. "No," said she, and she just went back, rocking back and forth. "Weren't you sleeping in bed beside him?" said Harry. "Yes," said she, "but I was on the inside." "You mean somebody slipped a rope around his neck, and you didn't wake up?" "No," said she. Well, Harry and I must have looked as if we didn't see how that could have been, for after a minute she said, "I sleep sound." Harry was going to ask her more questions, but I said maybe we ought to let her tell her story first to the coroner or the sheriff. So Harry ran as fast as he could to Rivers' place, where there's a telephone.
And how did she seem to feel once she knew you had gone for the coroner?
She moved from the rocker to that chair over there. She sat there with her hands in her lap, looking down. I got the feeling that I ought to make conversation, so I said I came to see if John would put in with me on a party telephone, and at that she laughed, and she stopped and looked at me, scared. I don't know if it was scared. I wouldn't like to say that it was. Soon enough, Harry got back, and the doctor, "You, Mr. Peter," so I guess that's all I know that you don't.
I guess we'll head upstairs first, and then out to the barn and around there. You're sure there's nothing important here, nothing that could point to any motive?
Nothing here but kitchen things.
Oh, well, here's a nice mess.
Oh, her fruit did freeze. She had worried about that when it got so cold out. She said the fire would go out and all her jars would break.
Well, can you beat the woman held for murder and worrying about her preserves?
Well, when we're through with her, she'll have something a little more serious than preserves to worry about.
Well, women are used to worrying over trifles.
And yet, for all their worries, what would we do without the ladies? Dirty towels? Not much of a housekeeper, would you say, ladies?
There's a great deal of work to be done on the farm.
To be sure. But I know some Dixon County farmhouses which do not have such a roll of towels.
But those towels get dirty awful quick. Men's hands aren't normally as clean as they might be.
Ah. Loyal to your sex, I see. You and Mrs. Wright were neighbors. I suppose you were friends, too.
Well, I've not seen much of her late years. And I haven't even been in this house since... Well, it's been years.
And why was that? You didn't like her?
Well, I liked her well enough. Farmers' wives have a great deal of work to do, Mr. Henderson. And then...
Yes?
It never seemed a very cheerful place.
No, it's not cheerful. I shouldn't say she had the homemaking instinct.
Well, I shouldn't say that Wright had either.
You mean they didn't get on very well?
No, I don't mean anything. All I'm saying is that a place may not be any more cheerful for John Wright's having been in it.
I'd like to talk more of this later. I think I'd like to get the lay of things upstairs now.
I suppose anything Mrs. Peters does will be all right. She wants to take in some clothes for her, you know, and a few little things. We left in such a hurry yesterday.
Yes, I'm sure that will be all right, Mrs. Peters. But keep an eye out for anything that might be important to us.
Yes, Mrs. Henderson. Well, I would hate to have men coming into my kitchen, snooping around and criticizing. Of course, it's no more than their duty. Duty is all right, but I guess that deputy sheriff that came out to make the fire got a little bit of this on. I wish I'd thought of that sooner. Seems mean talking about how she didn't have things slicked up when she had to come away in such a hurry. She had bread set. I was going to put this in there. It's a shame about her fruit. I wonder if there's any left. Oh, here's some. And it's cherries, too. I do believe that is the only one, though. She'll be sad about all the hard work she put in the hot summer. Ugh. I remember the day I put up my cherries last summer. Well, I must get those things from the broken closet. Close. I think that's what she kept to herself. She didn't even belong to the ladies' aid. But then, I guess you feel like you can't do your part when you feel shabby. I remember when she used to wear pretty clothes and be lively back when she was Minnie Foster. She was one of the town girls who sang in choir. Oh, that was
30 years ago.
Is all you want to take in?
She had said she wanted an apron. Funny thing to want. But there isn't much to get you dirty in jail, goodness knows. But I suppose to make her feel more natural. She said in her top drawer in this cupboard. Yes, here it is. And then the little shawl that always hung behind the door. Yes, here it is. Mrs. Peters. Yes, Mrs. Hale.
Do you think she did it?
I don't know. Well, I don't think she did it. Asking about her shawl and her apron, worrying about her fruit. Mr. Peters says it looks bad for her. Mr. Henderson is awful sarcastic in his speech. How many photographs are saying she didn't wake up? I guess John Wright didn't wake up when they were slipping the rope under his neck. No, it's strange. It must have been done awful crafty and still. They say it's such a funny way to kill a man, bringing it all up like that.
That's just what Mr. Hale is saying. There's a gun in the house. He says that's what they can't understand.
Mr. Henderson said coming in that what they needed for the case was a motive. Something to show anger or sudden feeling.
Well, I don't see any signs of anger around here. It's white to here. Wonder how the men are finding it upstairs. I hope she had a bit more red up there. You know, seemed kind of sneaky, locking her up in town and then coming out here trying to get her whole house to turn against her. Well, Mrs. Hale, the law is the law. I suppose it is. You might want to loosen up your things, Mrs. Peters. You won't feel them when you go out.
She was piecing a quilt.
Oh, it's a log cabin pattern. Pretty, isn't it? I wonder if she was going to quilt it or just knot it.
Huh? I wonder if she was going to quilt it or just knot it.
Huh? Frank's bar didn't do much up there, did it? Well, let's head up to the barn and get that cleared up.
I don't think it's so funny, us taking up our time with little things while we're waiting for them to gather the evidence. I don't see as it's anything to laugh about.
Of course, they have awful important things on their minds. Look at this. Look at the cell. All of our other pieces have been so neat and tidy. Look at this one. The sewing's all over the place, but it looks as if she didn't know what she was about. Oh, Mrs. Hale, what are you doing? Just pulling out a stitch or two that's not sewn very good. know she was so nervous about. I don't know if she was nervous. I'm sometimes so awful queer when I'm just tired. Well, I must get these things wrapped up. And maybe through sooner than we think. I wonder where I can find a piece of paper and some string. Did she have a bird? I don't know if she did or not. I've been here so long. Perhaps she did have a bird. There was a man about last year selling canaries cheap. Maybe she took one. Seems funny to think of a bird here. But she must have had one, or why would she have a cage? I wonder what happened to it. Maybe the cat got it. No, she has that feeling that some people have about cats, being afraid of them. My cat got into her. And she was real upset and she asked me to take it out. My sister Bessie was like that. Queer, ain't it? I wish if they were going to gather the evidence, they would be about it. Oh, I don't like this place. Unless I'm awful glad I came to you, Mrs. Hale. It would have been lonesome sitting all by myself. It would, wouldn't it? I tell you what I do wish, Mrs. Peters. I wish I'd come to visit sometimes. I really wish I had.
Well, of course, you were awful busy with your house and your children.
Could have come to visit. I stayed away because it's more cheerful, and that's why I should have come to visit. I don't know what it is about this place. Maybe because it's down a hollow and you can't quite see the road. Whatever it is, it's always been a dreary place. I should come to see Minnie Foster sometimes. I can see now. You must reproach yourself, Mrs. Hale. We sometimes don't see how it is with other folks. Not having children makes for less work, but it makes a quiet home. And with no company when Wright did come home from work. Did you know John Wright, Mrs. Peters?
Not to know him. I've seen him in town before. They say he was a good man.
Good, yes. He didn't drink, he paid his debts, kept his word as well as most, I guess. He was a hard man, Mrs. Peters. Just to pass the time of day with him. Like cold wind that cuts to the bone. I should think she would have wanted a bird. But what do you suppose went with it?
I don't know.
Unless it got sick and died. Raised around here, were you? You didn't know her? Not until they brought her yesterday. She, well, come to think of it, she's kind of like a bird herself. Real sweet and pretty, but timid and
change. Tell you what, why don't you take the quilt into her? It might cheer her up a bit.
Why, I think that's an awful nice idea. There couldn't possibly be any objection to it, could there? I wonder where some of her patches are and her things.
Look. Here's some red. I suppose she has some sewing things in here. Oh, what a pretty box. It looks like the kind of box that somebody gives you. Maybe her scissors are in here.
Oh, what?
This isn't her scissors. There's something wrapped up in this piece of silk.
Why,
it's the bird.
Mrs. Peters, look at it. Its neck, look at its neck, it's all other side too. Somebody wrung its neck.
Well, ladies, do we decide whether she is going to quilt this or not?
We think she was going to knot it.
That's interesting, I'm sure. Has the bird flown?
Oh, we think the cat got it.
Is there a cat?
Well, not now. They're superstitious. They leave.
No sign of having come from the outside. Their own room. I want to go up and go over it one more time. It would have to have been someone who knew just where John kept the rope, and Mrs. Wright is to be believed sleeping soundly.
She liked the bird. She was going to bury it in that pretty box.
When I was a girl, my kitten. There was a boy who took a hatchet. And before my eyes, before I could get to him, if they hadn't held me back, I would have hurt him. I wonder what it's like to have a house that's not full of children. No, Wright wouldn't like the bird. The thing that sang. She used to sing. He killed that, too.
We don't know who killed the bird.
I knew John Wright. It was an awful thing that was done in this house that night, Mrs. Hale. Killing a man in his sleep. Slipping a rope around his neck, choking the life out of him. His neck. The life out of him.
We don't know who killed him. We don't know.
There had been years and years of nothing. And then a bird to sing to you. It would be awful still. After the bird was still. I know what stillness is. When we homesteaded in Dakota. And my first baby died. At 2 years old. And me left with nothing but how soon do you suppose they'll be gathering the evidence? I know what stillness. The law has got to punish crime, Mrs. Hale. I wish you could have seen her when she was Minnie Foster and she wore white dresses and blue ribbons and stood in front of the town choir and sang. I should have come to visit. That was the crime. That was the crime. Who's going to punish that?
You mustn't take on.
I might have known she needed help. They know
you know how juries are when it comes to women? If only we find some definite thing, something to show, something to make a story about, something to connect up with this strange way of doing it.
I've got Harry and the team around. It's pretty cold out there.
I think I'm going to stay a while. You can send Frank up to me, can't you? I want to go over everything. I'm not satisfied that we can't do better.
Do you want to see what Mrs. Peters is going to take in?
Oh. I'm sure they're not very dangerous things the ladies have picked up. No. Mrs. Peters doesn't need supervising. And for that matter, a sheriff's wife is married to the law. Ever thought of it that way, Mrs. Peters?
Not just that way.
Married to the law. Oh, I just want you to come in here a minute, George. You ought to take a look at those windows.
Windows?
We'll be right out, Mr. Hill.
She was not going to quilt it. She was going to... What is it you ladies call it again?
We call it... knot it.